这个 Ashcroft， 然后第二个演讲者呢是ICHS 这边的Christopher， 然后第三位演讲者主讲人是我们 King An 的 Medical Director 陈议员陈医师。 OK， 所以我现在会用英文来欢迎我们所有的这个与会的贵宾。 Good morning everyone, I'm Ruping Xu. On behalf of King An HLP, I'd like to welcome all of you to join our MediHealth lecture todayIt's a special event for today. We are grateful to invite two organizations, Aegis Gardens Newcastle and ICHS, to cooperate with us. I'd like to thank Heidi Wong, ICHS Foundation Executive Director, and April Graves. She is here, Senior Advisor and Marketing Director at Aegis Gardens Newcastle. And of course, Angel Chi,from ICHS, she helps us to coordinate and interpret slides into Chinese for the first two speakers. The first speaker is Ashika from Aegis Garden. The second speaker is Christopher from ICHS. And then Dr. Yi Zhen Chen, the medical director of King An, will speak and make the conclusion for today.Since the time of the program is limited, we suggest you to hold your questions to the very end of today's lecture. Dr. Chen will host the Q&A session. Let's welcome April to introduce our first speaker. Hello, April. Hi, please.
There we go. Okay.I always forget that part. Thank you, Ruping, and Angel, and Ashika, and Heidi. We are super excited. This is the fourth of our educational series. We partnered, Aegis Gardens Newcastle partnered with ICH this past year, and we have been able to provide educational workshops.On the journey of aging and how to support families as they age. And this is the fourth of a series. And I'm super excited to introduce Ashika. She is, I'm going to read you some of her bio. And I was like, really, this is like one of the best bios actually I've ever read. It's really personable and you have such a broad level of experience. So Ashika is a licensed independent clinical social worker. And she's also an alumni from the University of Washington School of Social Work. Her curriculum and career has focused on mental health, historical trauma, family healing, intergroup dialogue, generational and gerontological,studies. She's had over a decade of experience providing compassionate clinical care with older adults, people with disabilities, families, caregivers, interdisciplinary teams, care communities, and health centers. She's well-versed in navigating the continuum of care and supporting clients in understanding Medicare, hospital stays, geriatric psychiatry,post-acute care, community resources, long-term care, home health, and death with dignity. And there's a lot more, but she is going to talk to us today about some of the challenges that families have been experienced during the pandemic with caregiving. And so she's going to talk about some of the challenges and offer strategies of well-being and how to get resources to help your family. Take it away.
Hi, well, thank you very much for having me. Let me start sharing my screen. Thank you very much for that introduction, April. Okay, thank you. Yes, today we'll be talking about a very important topic, which is how to support caregivers. Caregivers can come in very different roles, family caregivers, formal caregivers, supporting friends and family and neighbors. So this is a very broad group. In my years of service to caregivers and older adults, I've had the privilege of working with many people. And I have identified so much value in how caregivers are able to, what they're able to receive from that role. This is not an all-encompassing list, but some values that have been identified. Providing the physical, financial, and emotional care for one another, providing interpretations, whether that's language, whether that's the healthcare system, care, navigating different social and public resources, the duty to family and feeling very fulfilled from that role at times, connection to family, culture, spirituality, and the values within that family. Also working inside of the home and caring, working outside of the home and caring for within the home. And that can be a big thing to balance. A lot of heaviness can occur from all of these different roles. I had the privilege of working with a couple. We are going to call them John and Jane today. These are not their real names, but Jane did allow me to share her story in order to be able to help other people who might be in the same situation. John and Jane, they are 78, 74 years old, met in college, got married. Jane transitioned out of her program to start a family and happily married for 54 years. They had one son together who's living out of state and running his own business and very involved in that. I met them when John had a stroke. He had a stroke and had to come to our skilled nursing community for intense rehab. His stroke was pretty significant. He had several left-sided deficits, as well as changes to his swallowing ability, which actually impacted how he was the food consistency he ate. He was on something called artificial nutrition, which was kind of a big part of his rehab stay. So we'll learn about John and Jane through our talk today. Okay, lots of value for family caregivers. And let's go back to John and Jane. So John and Jane, John had a very long rehab stay. It was really focused on getting his ability to be able to transfer in and out of a bed, be able to walk with a walker, be able to transfer off of a toilet. And then also because of his artificial nutrition, try to strengthen his swallowing and train him to be able to swallow foods through the mouth again, and this is what ended up happening, is teaching Jane how to manage artificial nutrition. And that's what ended up happening. He was, at this time, wasn't able to regain his swallowing ability. And so the family really wanted to get him home be able to manage his care at home. That's what they did. They returned home. They had home health come, physical therapy, occupational therapy, a bath aide, and a nurse to help support Jane in his care. During this time, Jane really took on a lot of that load of caregiving, feeling the need to be there 24/7, managing all the appointments, transportation, food, care, all the activities of daily living, as well as the instrumental activities of daily living, like bill paying, finances. And these are some signs of caregiver burnout. This is really important to know, because sometimes we don't know what we might be feeling that is actually a sign of burnout and really a message for help. Physical and emotional fatigue, withdrawal from activities you love or people you love, feeling a lack of hope, maybe a lack of joy, feeling some negative emotions, maybe even anger, depression, shame, or guilt. Somatic conditions. So sometimes our bodies will communicate things that we may not be, will communicate things that are our body, through our body. That could be, pain. That could show up as pain in different parts of the body. Neglecting your own care needs, or your own appointments, or your own self-care. Changes in sleep, energy, concentration, or self-esteem. Abuse or neglect of the care receiver. What are some increased risks for caregiver burnout? While the caregiving environment's really changing to include all genders, it still primarily lands on the female of the family. So being female, having fewer years of formal education, living with the person you're caring for, social isolation, having some mood or depression at baseline, financial difficulties. Oftentimes family caregivers are kind of thrown in that role because that's what makes financial sense. Having a higher number of hours spent on caregiving than other things like your self-care, like work, like family. Lack of coping skills and difficulty problem solving. So at some point we become so fatigued that and not engaged in our coping skills that making decisions for ourselves and others can become more challenging. And the lack of choice of being a caregiver, sometimes related to that financial difficulties, we do what's needed for the family. Jane actually had a lot of these, being the female caregiver, having less education. She was really concerned about the finances and felt obligated to, meet the needs of her husband and be that primary caregiver who she's been the whole life for her and her family, as well as narrowing her life. Her world really became narrow because she was so focused on caregiving. So how can we support caregivers? We know this is a big part of the population, whether they are family, friends, neighbors, someone within your own community that you're supporting. So how do we support you who are choosing to, or sometimes not choosing to fulfill this role? Number one, care for yourself. That looks like a lot of different things. Identify your limits. There are limits in what we can do with time, function, finances, capacity. Be able to identify those limits and be okay communicating those limits. And seek support for the things you cannot do. Reduce those feelings of guilt and shame. When I was working with caregivers, and Jane in particular, she felt a strong duty to be able to do this for her husband and also for her son, so her son can continue his career and business. So she felt a lot of duty and would feel very bad, guilty, shameful if she was not able to fulfill that. Stay connected with others. Reduce your isolation. Keep your routines, whether that's going to your gym or your book club or your lunch date with your friends. Keep those routines and those connections. Ask for support. After identifying your limits, ask for your support. You have friends, family, professionals, and the community who are all here to be able to support you. Take time for yourself. Number one, take time for yourself. Eat well. And I also put here reduce inflammation. There's a lot of research that our gut health can impact our mental health. So being able to keep those good foods and a balanced nutrition, exercise and meditate. More ways to support caregivers, seek understanding and assessments. Really to educate and empower yourself with the options out there, with the disease process that you might be dealing with the different, and how to appropriately respond to different changes of behavior that you might be seeing associated with those disease process. Being able to seek that assessment early really allows for accurate diagnosis and engaging in different treatment options that may make a difference in how people process what's going on, as well as the treatment options and support. Seek professional support. You're not alone in this. There is a community around you who are familiar with this, who can support you. I call it multi-component interventions. There are many factors that can come in together to help support. It might not be just one piece. Jane had home health come in, and we'll talk about a little bit later the different aspects she decided to include. But connecting with specialists, whether that's a doctor, a community, a social worker, a therapist, different specialists who can really support you. Comprehensive counseling sessions, someone who's really looking at the person and environment and you as a whole person to really be able to support you in your goals. Support groups are great. You know, you're not alone in what you're experiencing and feeling. And it's a great way to build peer support, to normalize what you're going through and learn some tips and tools to help support. Hire help. It's okay to hire help. Respite care. So many of our wonderful communities like Aegis of Newcastle do offer respite care between a couple weeks to about 30 days, or, you know, April can discuss that more. But time for you to take a break and be able to reprieve from the 24/7 worries of caregiving. Adult day health care centers and home health. Another way to support caregivers, advanced planning. This is something I've heard from a multitude of caregivers that were so helpful when their loved one had already made the decisions of how they wanted to live, the treatments they wanted to do, and be able to make those decisions ahead of time. They felt like it was actually a gift for them to know how somebody wanted to live in the event of something happening. Who will assist in that decision-making? Starting the conversations early about how one wants to live, where they want to live, what medical treatments they may or may not want to have, and how their values impact that. And then having the paperwork put together. Pulse forms, power of attorney forms, living wills, dementia directives, mental health directives are all different forms to really be able to empower you and the people you love with making sure that their values are heard and their decisions are included when they may not be able to make the decisions for themselves. Back to John and Jane. So John and Jane are at home. Jane is taking on a lot of the caregiving responsibility. They've had home health, but at some point home health maxes out, whether somebody plateaus in therapy or their benefits max out. She ended up hiring some in-home care. That worked for a little bit until COVID happened, and different environmental factors can impact the number of caregivers out there, the consistency of those caregivers coming in the home, the confidence level Jane had in thinking if they can fulfill the care needs of John. And then After trying that, they decided to move into assisted living and memory care. Jane decided to move in with him in order to be close, but that doesn't always have to happen for a caregiver. John moved into memory care. From his stroke, he had some cognitive deficits that didn't regain after his work with therapy. And with his high level of care, he really benefited from the time and attention and the skill set of a memory care unit. And then Jane moved into assisted living, being able to have a smaller home setting where she could manage, as well as visit John daily or as often as she needed to, but most importantly, be able to really reduce her isolation and be able to engage in the activities that she loved. Everything was under one roof, and that made it really convenient for her. I also want to have some accountability about how us as professionals can support caregivers. We are all pieces of the puzzle together, and wrapping around our caregivers to really be able to fulfill their needs. As professionals, we can help you support and navigate the care service systems, the healthcare systems, the resource and benefit systems. By being able to support caregivers, we are directly supporting you, which have secondary effects for the care receiver. Being able to help you address distress and overall health and well-being, providing information and education, help you build confidence and competence in whatever you're engaging in. Be able to provide services that are culturally and linguistically appropriate, and even be able to do home visits and being able to really meet you where you're at. The other piece of this is being able to support the care receiver from both the professional end and the caregiving end. Advocacy for preferred care, as the caregiver, knowing the values and the goals and the hopes of what the care receiver will want, and being able to advocate for that, to be able to encourage the care receiver's voice and participation, be able to provide them emotional support. They've had a big change in function or change in cognition. Perhaps once independent and self-sufficient to now a shift towards needing assistance and support more often. So being able to provide the emotional support around those life changes, seeing their strengths, what can they do? What can they still engage in? Normalizing these life changes. This is a big one, to mirror the feelings and emotions expressed. Especially if someone is having cognitive decline, and reason and logic and information may not process in their brain, being able to respond with the emotions and the feelings you're seeing. Providing a sense of purpose, that is what makes us feel valued and meaningful in life, is having a sense of purpose. Caring for yourself is supporting the care receiver. Keeping connected to family, culture, spirituality, and values, and learn about preventing elder abuse. Several different resources around us, locally and nationally, to help support the caregivers. I'm happy to share these slides if that feels meaningful, to be able to follow up on some of these. And then different citations of where I got my information. I want to thank you all very, very much for allowing me to be on this journey with you and to share the information that I hope you found helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ashika. That was really helpful. Ruping, did you want to say something first?
Yes, thank you, Ashika. Thanks for your wonderful presentation. And then, Angel, will you introduce Christopher to all
of our audience? Yes, happy to.
Yes,
Yes. Hi, everyone. I'm Angel. I feel like some of you may know me because I have worked at Canon before. And I'm very familiar with everyone here. Hi. So Christopher is our behavioral health specialist at ICHS Bellevue Clinic. And so he will be speaking on kind of another perspective on how, as a provider, medical provider, how behavioral health is helpful to our patients that come in and seek care from providers. So I will be sharing screen for his presentation. And I will let Christopher take over with his presentation. Let me see if Christopher is on yet. I'll speak in Mandarin for a little bit. 大家好，其实我也会讲中文，所以如果在就是讲者的演讲过程有任何的问题，欢迎可以提问，也可以打在 chat 里面，然后我会尽可能的回答大家的问题。对，因为我们现在的时间有一点点就是提早。
那我想要请问一下大家，因为本来在 opening 的时候，我有跟大家提说，如果大家对于演讲者有一点内容有一些疑问，可以留到最后的时候再来询问。那现在刚好我们有一点时间，就是关于刚才 Ashika 提供的这一些建议，那想要了解一下大家有没有什么问题。 If you have any questions for Ashika's presentation, you might want to ask her right now. For example, maybe you are curious about how to avoid inflammation or the document you need to prepare. So if you don't have other questions, then I think we will let Christopher to begin today's presentation. Hi Christopher.
Hi, can everyone hear me?
Hi, yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great. I'm so sorry I'm late. I am on call as the only behavioral health therapist here. And so I was a little late coming in, but I'm glad to be here with everyone. I work at ICHS, the behavioral health therapist again, or specialist. And I've been doing this for a while. Quick, just background about me, I was running an after-school STEM program before this for about 7 years, and then transitioned over to therapy, to a therapy role. Got my master's in social work with clinical and mental health track, and so that's my specialty. So I was asked today to talk about when to seek support, common myths and misconceptions about therapy, especially in the Asian American community. So I'm really happy to be here and to join everyone, and hope I can provide some really great insight. Next slide, please. So before I delve into what I want to talk about, I do want to talk about different modalities of care. And when I talk about modalities, what I mean by that is how care is given in specific therapeutic places. So there's outpatient, inpatient, all of these different arenas of therapy. And so I want to kind of discuss short-term versus long-term care. So ICHS has an integrated care model where therapists are intertwined with PCPs or primary care providers to address behavioral health needs that can be worked on within a 6-month period. So we're a short-term therapeutic site, often focusing on skill building to maintain a healthy lifestyle or increase in functionality to ultimately lead in positive lifestyle changes. So things that your primary care provider or your doctor or your nurse practitioner or your physician's assistant, things that they task us with is, you know, creating skills for memory building for our elderly folks, or it may be working on short-term depression or what's called an adjustment disorder, things of that nature. We also do things like welfare checks and do a little bit of med management, checking in on patients' symptoms and whatnot. But we're different from what's typically referred to as a typical therapist role. Next slide, please. And that's more so where long-term therapy or long-term therapists come into play. So long-term therapists not only work on skills, but also usually delve into trauma history and are likely to see clients for a longer period of time and increase in appointment frequency, depending on levels of care needed. So that's, you know, the typical Freudian style, like let's sit back on a chair or a couch and let's look at the ceiling. You often see that in movies. It also really depends on people's practices. So it just really depends on the type of therapy that you're looking for. Different therapists also focus on different types of therapy. So there are different modalities in that realm, such as cognitive behavioral therapy, acceptance and commitment therapy, dialectical behavioral therapy. It just really depends on what the client is looking for and also what the therapist specializes in. Next slide, please. So common myths when people think about behavioral health while working with senior living members. The first one is therapists can solve memory issues. That comes up more often than not. And the shorter answer is we cannot. sorry, go ahead, you can go to the next slide. However, therapists can work on building skills together with a client, which have been successfully proven to keep memory and the creation of memory sharp, like staying active, having great conversations, socializing regularly, eating a healthy diet, working on sleep hygiene, reading, finding hobbies, taking classes, doing puzzles, things of that nature. And what we do, or what we do at ICHS, is we create what's called behavioral contracts in which we ask the client, hey, do you want to work on these things? Okay, great. Let's kind of lay out a foundation or a plan to, you know, elicit some of these things to happen, and let's see and let's track maybe what works and what doesn't. And have you created memories from this? Is your memory sharp? Those kinds of things. So creating those benchmarks with our clients in order to retain memory. Other folks will, you know, have a neurology referral in which they do brain scans and they check in on different memory function and the place where in your brain memory flares and keeps and holds. And they'll start to talk about cognition and cognitive decline. We are not neurologists though. We work solely on the skill building aspect of memory care. Next slide. Second thing is discuss the difficult reasons why a client may not be able to retain memory due to traumatic instances. And so oftentimes we see clients that have unfortunately traumatic histories in which they either block out or disassociate. And oftentimes that disassociation leads to different cognitive declines later on in life. And so often exploring that with clients, usually sometimes, or I would say, yeah, but usually there are sort of light bulbs being clicked on in their minds in which help them to figure out where it all comes from, where it stems from, where their dissociations stem from, whatnot. Next slide. Last, we can work with families to do crisis intervention and help provide them with resources needed for the client. So oftentimes when you speak with older folks, depression is also associated with memory or cognitive decline. And so I can get can answer any questions about that. However, what we do is we sort of speak with the client, talk through any situations they may be going through, and offer emotional support, and also help them provide them with resources. So looking at different memory care units or different assisted living homes with them, providing resources in that realm. Next slide. Next common myth is my therapist has all the answers and can solve all my problems. that also comes up quite a bit, especially with senior living members, and I think that's very interesting. So what I wrote was, great therapists will never lead anyone to answers they create for their clients, but rather walk alongside them to help clients find the answers within themselves. So the first thing I want to say about therapy and therapists is that we're very much human. We have opinions. We have ideas of what the answer is, right, to any question that a client brings up. But a good therapist will never give you their answer. They will never say, you should do this. They will often hold that to themselves and work alongside you, ask you questions, help you to think about different things so that you can figure that answer for yourself, okay? And if you're ever in a therapist situation where they're just telling you answers, that's not therapy. That's a counselor's role. That's what counseling is, all right? Next slide, please. Now, common misconceptions I hear a little bit or a lot of. First one is, if I go to therapy, something is wrong with me, or only crazy people go to therapy. Next slide. You know, back 30, 40 years ago, if you told anyone you went to therapy, they thought you were nuts. They thought you were bonkers. They thought you were crazy. And that was a big misconception. Right? It's so interesting. So the first thing is that emotionally healthy people have therapists. A lot of CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, they all have therapists. And it's not that they're emotionally unhealthy or healthy people. It's just that everyone is doing therapy now. So you might have been around a dinner table 40 years ago and been like, oh, my therapist said this and people thought you were crazy. Now you do that today and a lot more people are more accepting. They're like, oh yeah, what did your therapist say? So I hear a lot of really great conversations about therapy now. A second is that we often focus on our physical health, but not our mental health. So let's say you break your leg, right? You break your leg. We are, of course, going to go to the doctor. We're going to go to the surgeon. We're going to, you know, want someone to fix that for us, or we want help with that. But let's say we break up with someone, or we lose a parent or a loved one. Most people don't go to therapy for that, even though there is a large amount of emotional pain going on. And so we have to, as a community especially, start to disseminate or dissemble what that means and how do we start to address those internal needs rather than just focusing on our physical needs. Lastly, therapy is also deemed as preventative work, so we can do or go through bouts of emotionally tumultuous times and we're better able to adapt and handle those situations. So on the physical side, your doctor, of course, wants you to exercise, to eat healthy, to get vitamin D, to take supplements, right? Emotionally preventative work means that when we are troubled with something that's difficult, let's say we lose a loved one, we're better able to emotionally handle those situations, or we're at least able to go to someone to talk about, you know, these troubling times. I always say this, if you don't have a therapist, hopefully you have someone that you're emotionally available with that you can talk through, because that's also very healing. Next slide. All right, another common misconception. Therapists only speak English, and so they won't understand me, or they won't understand cultural differences or what I'm going through. Next one. Did you know that at ICHS, we have a handful of therapists at ICHS that speak either Mandarin, Cantonese, or both. We also use interpretive services. You can search for the therapists online via databases and filter your search for your specific criteria if you don't want to go through ICHS. So you can filter different things. You can pick specific gender, insurance types of therapy used. You can, if you don't want to go through ICHS and you want to find your own private therapist, there are online databases you can use to filter your search so that you can pick what or who you would like to talk to. Some therapists use translation services, like I talked about, or interpreters in order to communicate with their clients. So, you know, if there is a language barrier, hopefully the therapist will use some sort of translation service. And I didn't put this in here, but I kind of wanted to discuss something else. One thing to note is that great therapists do their best to have some sort of cultural relevancy and understand what people go through or have the training to understand and say, yes, I am not of the same cultural background as you, but help me to understand. Let's walk through this. Let's talk through this. So hopefully everyone's able to find someone really great. Next slide. Cognitive signs for loved ones to consider seeking help, especially for therapeutic or help with either a neurologist from their PCP and whatnot. So the first one is easiest to show: memory decline, not remembering family members' faces, or not remembering to take medications. Second one is decreased driving competency, forgetting where they are, inability to follow directions, not remembering specific street names, not remembering when to turn, those kinds of things. Cognitive decline, which leads to disorientation or becoming lost when outside of the home. So this kind of goes to the previous one, is not being able to understand where they are or follow directions. Changes in mood and aggressive behavior or irritability. Aggressive behavior may be associated with confusion and dementia. It's also may be associated with adult onset depression. Last one, differences in judgment or making decisions that aren't usually acceptable social norms. So signs like that, maybe doing things in the home that aren't usually that things they haven't done in the past. Go ahead. And this last one, how do we address elderly family members when starting to explore the idea of living in a senior living home? So reflecting back on my clients who are asking similar questions, there's a very strong sense of integrity that is echoed over generations and generations, especially in the Asian community. The basic message that is, it is not okay to fall apart, gets constantly reinforced. Therefore, clients find it difficult to accept that cognitive decline and physical ailment is oftentimes a part of aging. Cultural norms also often dictate that the younger generation will take care of their elderly no matter what. So when it comes to the question of how do we address elderly family members when starting to explore the idea of living in a senior living home, our elders need to feel that the decision is made by their own choices, by their own autonomy, or at least be a part of the conversation with their loved ones when exploring the idea, rather than feeling like, oh, I need to go to a home because I'm old or incapable or taking care of myself, or because my family doesn't want to take care of me, or that I'm a burden on them. We don't want them to feel that way. We want to have them or make them feel as if they have the autonomy or the choice to make it themselves. A big thing when exploring this question is, are we doing our best to be empathetic to our loved ones? And what is empathy? Well, empathy is, you know, putting ourselves in another person's shoes. And if you can only imagine what that's like for a second, you know, having that question be posed to you, you know, so trying to hold on to this idea of empathy. Family members can also aid, you know, their loved ones, their elderly, by helping them to identify specific things to explore, like different living environments, the degrees of independence, current availabilities of support, financial commitments, you know, different types of living situations, especially with different types of assisted living homes. So touring different ones, going to different places, those kinds of things. Lastly, it's also important to combat guilt from the family members who are sending their loved ones to an elderly folks home by reminding them there's no right decision. There's only the best decision for that situation. And oftentimes we compare our situation to other situations, like, oh, Sally's mom is 95 and she can do everything. She's still at parties, her memory's sharp, all these kinds of things. She's up, she's cooking. And my person, my loved one is 70 and going through all of these different things. There's a lot of guilt and anger there for our younger the younger folks who are sending their elderly in that home. And we have to understand that there's no right decision or no one perfect situation. There's only the best decision for that situation. And oftentimes that best decision is, you know, figuring out or doing the thing that we all really don't want to do sometimes, and putting our elderly in a home. So, but there should be no guilt in that. And that's my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Christopher. Thanks. And thank you, Angel. And the speaker from our King An is Dr. Yi Zhen Chen. He is our medical director for King An. And he concerns about the retirement living for a long time. He takes care of the members for a long time, so he's going to tell us how to take care of ourselves financially, physically, and mentally. Let's welcome Dr. Yi Zhen Chen.
Okay, I'll be talking in the Mandarin, because not only Seattle people will listen, people from Taiwan also will be listening. So I'll be speaking Mandarin. because today's topic, 我用中文讲。 那因为大概三个礼拜前跟我沟通的是长期照护在后疫情, 这个 pandemic 以后的情形, 那现在呢, 这个, 我的重点只要讲这一部分，那刚刚两位有讲的也是我里面常常提的 mental 的 issue，那我在2020年3月大爆发的时候，我在建安就一直提出来要 mental PPE，要做这些心理上的照护啦准备，那刚刚两位讲的非常好，那我讲的就是我们整体的各。 除了在长照机构要准备，我们个人的方面也是要做准备的这个长期照顾的心理身体的准备。那你这个 slide 是这样下去，我要 slide show。 OK。 这一张是2018年我在台中花博的时候看到的这个 building， 看起来很像我们的 COVID-19 virus 哦，这是一个 World Fair 的那个 building 哦，那很像。那我们回到主题，就是2020年爆发的，那时候初期叫做武汉肺炎，后来改为 COVID-19， 那病源就是 SARS-CoV-2 哦。那我那时候就画了一张图哈。 那就是说，在武汉爆发的一颗超级原子弹，然后影响到全世界整体的是那个 Worldwide Cultural Revolution 整个全世界的文化大革命。那大家那时候大家没有真的体会那现在可以看出来，整个各行各业、政治、经济、文化、医疗照顾全部变动那我画在这个图，就是说那个 virus 呢，我们重点是在 coronavirus。 然后呢，它主要的是 SARS-CoV-2 那从 SARS-CoV-1 变出来，然后它引起的就是武汉肺炎，现在叫做 COVID-19 那最近爆发的就是它的 variant 那突变种，那我们正在整体的全世界都在面对这一个，那在针对它想办法来应付那我简单讲一下呢，这个它影响的是什么它影响的开始 SARS-CoV-1 是影响的是肺部。 尤其是下呼吸道 哦，那现在是 SARS-CoV-2 呢，它影响是全身各系统，哦，从脑部、肺部、肝脏、肾脏、肠胃系统、肌肉、皮肤、血液系统、神经系统全部牵涉进去，因为那个病毒到处跑，它产生的破坏力非常强，哦，那么这样的话呢，它所引发的病变，哦，不是只有以前担心的那个肺部而已，哦，那它是引起的全身。那么全身的话呢，它我们现在才在两年多三年，哦，那它以后续的演化的变，身体的改变还有产生的新的疾病呢，都一直在出来，哦，所以整个医疗教育系统、医师的养成的教育呢，全部在改变，哦，因为病完全不一样了。然后呢，现在我们为了救整个世界呢，我们赶快研发这个疫苗还有治疗药物，那么这些都很可能除了救我们现在的情况，让大家可以赶快进入正常的生活状态，但是它将来引起的问题现在都还不知道，哦，所以呢，我要提出来这个长期照顾呢，不是只有机构式照顾，还有我们的身体心理的照顾全部都牵涉进去，而且是在都是未爆弹，哦，完全不知道，哦，所以呢，这个我们很需要知道我们怎么来准备一个长期方面的照顾自己，哦，照顾家人的对应模式，哦，所以那时候这个 COVID-19 引发的就是我们第一个能做的就是把全世界都用口罩封起来，哦，所以大家那时候的紧张状态找不到口罩呢，这是非常紧张，哦，那时候我们每天的生活都是生活在未爆弹，到处都是那个地雷，哦，不晓得怎么办，那都不敢见面，哦，所以呢是那个叫做 worry o'clock 了，哦，很紧张，那又不能聚在一起，又不能见面，哦，很头痛。那么等于是说我们那时候的心情，尤其是医疗人员呢，是在水深火热之中，哦，因为完全是敌人都在旁边，那不晓得怎么办。那后来我们终于有了疫苗出来了，那大家马上改变，哦，我们可以感觉到在两个礼拜内马上没有人送到医院去了，哦，很快，所以呢，这个是一个很好的帮助，但是呢，后面的事情我们都还不清楚，哦，那现在就是说整个世界呢，不是只有美国，哦，全世界呢，因为这一次的疫情以后才发现我们的很多医疗照顾系统、公共卫生系统呢都有很大的缺失，但是呢，以前是不知道，哦，以前就是照大家照平常的运作啦，照顾身体啦、心理啦，这样在生活，现在发现非常的多的缺失，所以那时候大家可以看到那个媒体的报道呢很紧张，哦，那纽约是病人死的人啊，什么都是没有地方放，哦，然后加州也是，然后佛罗里达州，你看佛罗里达州的老人死亡率，哦，占 60%、哦，这些都是提醒整个世界，尤其是我们现在讲的是美国呢，赶快两党配合起来，赶快想办法应对这个，哦，所以那时候马上改了非常多的法规，像很多退休的医疗人员马上拜托他们回来工作，那有些国外的医师呢，那美国需要的就准许他们进来工作，也不用考核他的执照，怎么说，非常多改变。那时候也是因为整个像口罩都没有啦，那防护系统啦，这些都没有，哦，那整个怎么办法呢，大家想办法去找这个资源了，哦，那这就是说整个政治经济呢全部改变，就是要面对这个突然发的那个整个的那个大问题，哦，所以这个变成说这样的关系呢，它改变很多以后呢，变成整个美国的社会、西欧社会、那亚洲社会都在改变，那都在制定自己能够应对的政策，哦，那这样的话呢，我们今天讲的长照就是我们要知道这些改变，然后我们要怎么准备，哦，那这个呢，不是只有当初是也只有以为是老人65岁以上，哦，大家是非常紧张怎么样，现在牵涉进去的是全民，哦，不是只有老人，哦，它包括残障人士、年轻人，哦，还有少数民族偏远人士啦，哦，各种行业，哦，都牵涉进去，全部要改变，那全部要规划，哦，那这样，所以呢，联邦政府、州政府都想办法赶快 设立很多不同的单位、哦、来准备，像、啊、如何教育医护人员、啊、教育人民、啊哦、还有资源的赶快收集制造啦，还有呢这个服务方面怎么去做，那现在人员缺乏怎么办呢、哦、这样、哦、所以呢变成说各行各业还有政府的各机构都想办法在对应这个 COVID-19、哦、所以呢这个呢所以说我们一直在提的，我在2020年3月大爆发以后我就提我们一定要 mental PPE、哦、的心理的照顾，因为 COVID 是那时候的 pandemic， 再下来就是心理问题，大家因为关得太久焦虑得很厉害，所以呢各种事情心理方面的病都会出来、哦、所以刚刚两位讲得很好，就想办法要支援照顾者还有支援我们自己的情形、哦、那时候 有一个非常有名的就是 Hug Hungry、哦、这些老人关在机构里面、哦、疗养院啊退休社区啊什么呢都不准见家人、哦、有很多老年人就这样走了，那连跟家人见最后一面都没机会、哦，所以现在才发现说那时候至少 20% 的人都没有做任何准备、哦、那就这样就走了，那有一些走的呢连家人去都不能去、哦、就是医院直接办葬礼、哦、那就处理掉、哦、就是这样，所以很可怜、哦、所以呢我们现在就是要超前部署，要准备如何面对我们自己的还有自己的家人的老化以后的那个长期的照顾的规划、哦，那心理上呢由于呢这个整个疫情的关系呢我们大家都非常焦虑非常紧张，然后都很多人都把自己关起来、哦、不敢见外面的人、哦、那这样的关系呢那个整个、要去上班的人 的情形也全部打断、哦、家里人的照顾啦，所以呢变成很多焦虑很多忧郁，那很多行为不正常、哦，这些都是心理，都是因为被关押的太厉害、哦、那这样的话呢在美国至少 46% 的人呢他心理是朝负面思考的、哦、很紧张这样的、哦、那有很多在这个家里人自己有发生或自己发生以后呢觉得非常的无力感、哦、要不想要怎么办对不对，那这样的话呢如何来做你心理的复健、哦、那这个呢我们建安的那个 Health Limit 呢是做非常多的工作来持续的来帮忙这些愿意来一起参与的、哦、这个都是互相运作了、哦、那我本身在建安也是每个礼拜带他们做运动啦跟他们演讲啦叫这样来教育他们让他们心里能够宽松下来、哦、所以呢长远的来讲我们要好好的做自己的心理的复健、哦，那要朝正面的思考然后参与该做的活动、哦、不要把自己一直关起来、哦、尤其是我们年龄越老呢越 不学新的东西，那么现在很多都是那个叫做 digital push、哦、都是电脑网络三 C 这些的东西呢一定要去学了、哦、不然的话会很厉害的隔离起来，那这非常很焦虑、哦、这里有一个
陈医师、
yeah.
请问一下 PPE 是什么、
哦、那个叫做防护那个啦，防护设备啦，防护衣啦，口罩啦，哦，这个就是 PPE 哦。我们一般人到疗养院、到医院、到诊所去都要戴口罩啦，戴防护衣啦，哦，对不对？那心理上也要做这一方面的防护了，哦，这个是这一个名词，哦 ，OK， 好、哦，所以呢，心理上的调试呢，我们就是要好好的去训练自己。那不要把自己关押起来、哦、要参与活动这样才能够调试、哦、那所以我最近提出来就是我们老就要努力的去训练自己参与一些活动才能够享受我们的晚年了、哦、这是我们的心理上的长照、哦、而不是把自己都关在家里什么都不去什么都不参加什么都不学那每天只看着电视、哦、那是非常不好的活动、哦，那身体的照顾呢除了我们平常提的该做的照顾、哦、就像第四样 healthy living、哦、就是 preventive 预防性的照顾、哦、这个是长期上一定要做的，再来就是医疗的照顾、哦、curative 跟 palliative、哦、这个三个请大家记得、哦、preventive curative and palliative、哦、 那 medical care 的方面呢，就是该做的照顾去治疗，那不需要的治疗延长生命并没有好处呢，就要减痛照顾、哦、这是我们平常都有在提的。那么这一次 COVID-19 以后呢，整个世界改变，尤其是美国西欧世界改得非常厉害、哦、那么本来是等一下会有提的、哦、老挝的部分、哦、现在尽量都改成是网络的那个、哦、就是 digital 的那个 telehealth 了、哦、就是视讯方面的看病。那这样的话呢，我们老年退休老年人，如果你没有学、哦、在美国统计呢，只有 13.4% 的人，老年人尤其是80岁以上的人还有在看 internet， 那表示说 87% 的人没有用 internet， 那也只有 24% 左右有 smartphone、哦、有手机，那表示说如果我们更老对这 3C 产品、啊、什么都不用的话，那非常的糟糕，因为以后你没办法适应以后的医疗照顾，现在已经全部在改这方面，所以变成说以后是家庭到家里来的服务的照顾加重，那到医院去的减少，那这样的话呢，这个照顾方向都不一样，那整个美国的医疗照顾在改方向，已经在慢慢一直在改了，所以大家可以最近可以看到 Amazon 也在买他的医疗照顾，CVS 也整个药物那个药科药房系统也在买诊所，他们买去就是要改变照顾方式，遵照他们的方向来决定，那变成我们每个人没有控制权了、哦、所以他们这样是整体在改变了、哦、这个是因为 COVID-19 以后整个在改变、哦、那个人的照顾方面呢，现在很多已经改成慢慢改成在家里照顾，那等于是派照顾人员到家里来，因为这些老人已经慢慢的不去机构住了，那么这样的话呢，家里的照顾很重，那么家里照顾的话呢，你要准备你的家是不是适合人家来，而且住的地点、哦、你不能住在深山里面这非常漂亮的大房子呢，但是没有人能去、哦、所以变成这方面 的照顾呢都要改变、哦、那还有呢，刚刚有提的那些 prearrangement 啊 advance directive 这些呢，你要预设好、哦、刚刚有提呢 20% 的老人呢完全没有准备、哦、那就走了，所以呢最近慢慢提升到 40%、哦、就是说你的身体要怎么照顾，你的财产要怎么处理、哦、这个都要去指定排好、哦、那这样的话呢才能够好好的照顾你的身体，尤其是往年的身体哦、往后的生命、哦、老年的生命，这个都需要长期照顾的了、哦、并不是年轻人一样看一次病五六年才看一次、哦、不一样、哦、那这样的话呢就是要注重你该有的养生、哦、养生不是只是在网那个在媒体网络上在送来送去的什么都不做了，什么都 都不吃了，什么都不做、哦、那个不对、哦、你要参与积极参与照顾你身体的各项活动，那该打的预防针也要打、哦，那这样才能够好好的照顾你的身体、哦、这里是几个图、哦、深的蓝色这是全部不打预防针的，它住院率死亡率相当高、哦、那浅蓝色是打了两针，那住院率还是死亡率还是高了一些，那个灰色这个咖啡色这个呢就是有打针的，他们的比例就少很多、哦、这样、哦、那这个也是一样，这个 spec 上面来的呢都是年轻人，他们不打针的呢这个确诊率高，住院率 也多了一些了、哦、那最底层的平的这些就是都有好好的打针的、哦、那这样的话呢就比较能够减轻社会的负担，也减轻自己、哦、还有家人的负担了、哦、那至少我们的这个年龄都是老人呢，也不用担心这个预防针到底有没有合理啦，有些人反对打预防针、哦、也不用担心它会不会产生副作用、哦，因为我们的时间只有那么一点点、哦、我们的昨天的越来越多，明天的越来越少、哦、那这样的话呢我们只能够安稳的走完这一段日子是最重要的了、哦、那住的方面呢以前、哦、照平常以前的是住在自己家里，很多 90% 的美国老人是希望在自己家里终老、哦、但是到某一个状况呢，你家里人住在家里是不安全，然后也没人，就是说你还要照顾家里房子啦、哦、庭园啦，还有很多东西呢 那病人说去住在退休社区、哦、那第二个就是 retirement home 大家去住那个地方、哦、然后如果说身体状况还是不好还是说财务方面问题那么就住在那个 share 的跟人家分担房子的再来就是身体有稍微问题就住在 assisted living 那边有护士随时有需要的时候他会来帮忙不然就是更重的就到 adult family home 或 group home 最后就是到 nursing home 这是我们一系列的美国及西欧、哦、那台湾现在也是在加强朝这方面的这个、哦、慢慢朝机构式 的集体住宅在朝那边走、哦、那但是呢 COVID-19 以后呢整个改变、哦、西欧世界呢发现像加拿大呢死亡率 75% 就住在这种社区出来的、哦、那美国是 41% 欧洲 47%、哦表示说集体住在一起呢虽然是照顾方面方便但是呢对于大的疫情呢没办法应付、哦、那除了那个资源不够人员不够还有呢没办法好好隔离、哦、保持距离啦隔离啦这些都做不到、哦、尤其是住在机构里面的这些老人呢他们病比较多、哦、有比较多种身体状况那么他体力比较弱免疫力都比较弱的话呢很容易、病重那么这样的话呢变成说反而发现住在自己家里的这一批人的死亡率降低很多、哦、那这样的话呢变成说很多老年人到现在决定不去住机构式的那么这样怎么办、哦、那么我们现在我们也是这一批老人慢慢进场了、哦、我们的未来的走向也可能是这样那么你要住在自己家里的话那么所有的服务都送到家里来、哦、包括最近的住院、哦、你说有心脏病啊什么病、哦、如果病情没有那么严重的就不需要住院马上送回家里在家里照顾他派医疗人员到家里来每天来看一下啦那么这样的话呢你家里人就要帮忙照顾了、哦、那刚刚第一个演讲者 caregiver depression 啊照顾者要怎么办呢哦、还有呢你买的长照保险能不能 cover 到够服务这些、哦、这个是走向在朝这方面走、哦、所以呢变成说美国西欧世界呢慢慢朝向住在自己家里终老那么所有的医疗服务送到家里来、哦、那这样我们的准备是什么、哦、你除了要长期照顾的保险以外还要准备一笔足够的资金、哦、来应付这个当然他现在就是走向就是尽量不让你用昂贵的医疗服务啦、哦、那就是到医院去啦到疗养院这一些呢他就这一部分就减少了那到家里来的这个就增加、哦、那这个我们要准备你的家里的情况家里的财务家里的人员配合能不能应付、哦、所以呢这里刚刚有提到的就是朝向以家里为主啦、哦、所以我们几年来一直在提的 PSCE 这个 program、哦、这个是就是 Under G 啦、哦、这个是在 San Francisco 我们华人发展出来的现在是2015年奥巴马总统定为全国政策的长照系统、哦、那台湾的健长照系统也是朝这方面在走、哦、那这个呢它就注重你尽量留在家里那有实在是不得已才送到机构去、哦那这样的话呢这个模式可能最近会提升上来、哦、因为这样比较符合未来的长照的走向了、哦、就是说 这里讲的、哦、去机构化的照顾了、哦、disinstitutionalization、哦、这样、哦、那重点就是因为要预防下一次的大流行、哦、那大流行基本上最很大很大的是每100年一次了、哦、那比较刺激的大概每10年、哦所以呢这个就是我们这一批老人也要准备了、哦、那这样的关系呢各种残照机构呢 要应付、哦、对应这个生存呢他们都在改变、哦、那全美国呢这个残照就是疗养院啊这些机构呢已经关了大概160家了、哦、那华盛顿州关了25家那最近的媒体报道呢华盛顿州的医院、哦、像华大啦瑞士医院啦西北医院这些呢损失18亿、哦、一年损失18亿每一个星期损失 千万的哦。那这些机构都在改变，他们可能会精简很多照顾哦，因为没办法支应这些红字哦，所以呢会关掉很多服务哦。那这个我们长照方面，所以我常听到大家在 complain 说要约时间都约不到哦，那其实是实在是没有办法，没有钱哦，那就一直在削减哦。所以呢，就是说我们在老窝的方面呢，就是说他朝向于住在家里提供各项服务，那么这些需要很多的训练人员，而且我们自己的每一个人要准备自己家里适应这个长期照顾这个老人的各方面的安排了，照顾的人员家属的照顾或照顾者的安排，财务的安排，还有他里面的设置，房子里面无障碍设置啦，要怎么做啦，让这些老人能够留在家里到最后，而不用去住到机构，那这个都是 要想办法、哦、那这样的话呢，我们就提到的最很基本的啦，那钱怎么办呢？钱在哪里呢？除了刚刚有提的有 20% 的老人突然就是因为 COVID-19 就走了，那完全没有安排他的财务方面的安排，现在已经增到 40% 了、哦、至少有讲一下你的财产啦、房子啦要怎么处理、哦、还有就是说我们一定要确定去买长期照顾的保险，因为将来的照顾是这一部分会很重。我刚有提很多这个 COVID-19 的病呢，它可能会是未爆弹、哦、慢慢在变、哦、那么这样的话呢，可能会慢慢的产生出来，那尤其是在这个现在呢，几乎已经没办法零确诊、哦、有症状跟无症状的都会有、哦、美国预测是 99%、哦、那有症状的是50%几了、哦、那无症状 40%， 那这个多多少少都会有关联、哦、那么这样的话你可能现在没有事，可能一年两年五年以后就一些病出来了、哦、那么这样就需要照顾，这些你要去准备、哦、那有些主张是把你在现在的现有的钱放一笔，是专门照顾你这个可能产生的 post pandemic 的问题，还有活动或处理了、哦、就是一笔钱专门对这个，不能拿去乱花，或者不能就交给小孩子啊什么、哦、那到时候你需要用的时候没有这个钱了、哦、所以这个是要去准备、哦、所以呢我大概时间过了、哦、我主要提的就是说我们的今天的题目是长照在 post pandemic 的我们的规划、哦、不是只有住在疗养院叫做长照、哦、我们的整个各方面住在家里各方面的准备都要去做、哦、那重点就是说你要先设定好你到底要的是什么的晚年、哦、那好好的去想，那你该做的养生呢要去做、哦、那我知道很多人都是看着电视看着网络、哦、那该做的活动不去做呢，这个可能现在没事，但是呢过一阵子以后的一个一个病都出来、哦、所以呢要去做、哦、你先设定好你要的是什么、哦、那你担心的是什么，去好好的查出来，那能不能处理、哦、去做、哦、这个是脑心的、哦、这些部分去做，那应该跟外面联络的、哦、要去维持了、哦、不要全部切断、哦、那因为你越切断你的心理越不正常、哦、越孤僻，会焦虑会紧张，那么你变成你越需要你的家人帮你忙的地方非常动、哦、那其实你有很多地方你跟你的亲朋好友大家联络啦活动呢，心理调试的好你就不会有这些问题出来、哦、那这样的话你照顾你的人就不会那么辛苦了、哦、那第四样就是说 healthy living， 我们健康有提的这个这些活动，很多活动你可以选几样好好去做、哦、像我刚提的业精于勤，就是你选几样要有规律的耐心的去做、哦、那你可以确定一天花多少时间在做养生的运动啦，这些呢参加的活动、哦、那这样的话呢对你慢慢的都有好处、哦、你多一点运动你的寿命的品质会更好、哦、所以该去做的要去做，那你如果习惯不容易养成，就参加这个我们的慢性病自我管理课、哦、 这些课堂会教你如何养成习惯，如何照顾你自己的身体。好，那环境方面呢，就是你的居家呢，现在慢慢朝向居家照顾啦。好，那么这样的话，你的环境越简单越好，因为你年纪越大做不到很多喜欢的啦。那家里很大，空间很大，房子很多，那么谁去处理呢？谁去管？谁去整理？这个就是要慢慢去瘦身了。那自己的心理方面呢，要朝向正面思考呢，就是说多参加活动，让你的朋友会互相鼓励，这样呢 才比较能够维持好正面的思考了。所以这个对也是自己的身心的长期照顾。好，那 要小心你自己的心理。那很多老年人尤其是已经有失智轻度中度的呢，他不会察觉自己心理有问题，总是认为别人有问题。所以这个呢变成说我们都要互相注意了。这个是我们的老本老窝老身老心呢，可以简单的提着未来的走向是这样，那我们能做的是什么。好，那我大概今天就讲到这里。那现在就是欢迎大家有没有什么要提问的。
陈医师，我有一个问题，我是 Peter Wong。你刚刚有提到说因为那个 pandemic 的关系啊，在那个老人社区或 care facility 那个死亡率蛮高的，所以你说未来的倾向，未来设计的长照的倾向是在家里照顾，就是对不对？那在家照顾，在家照顾这个也不是新的观念了，对不对？以前也是有。我是想说老人社区这个概念啊，其实已经很久了，而且我相信很有好处嘛，对不对？大家年纪差不多住在一起，一起聊天，对那个身心方面的，尤其是那个 mental health 方面很有帮助吧，朋友很多等等。现在他们把那个为了因为那个 pandemic 的关系，现在把他们都，我不是把他们多了，就是说他们就是开始说啊，那在家里照顾怎么等等，那就有点把那个以前那个好处就是有点就是消除了、啊。所以换句话说，我觉得他们这个新的倾向也会有副作用的、啊，所以不晓得这个以后是怎么演变，不晓得。
主要是这样，因为这一次的 pandemic 以后呢，发现很多的死亡率高的都是在机构里面的，那么这样的呢，整个 community 这些老人，包括你我、哦、想说我、哦、以后我不敢去住那里了，因为一个传染就一大堆人走了、哦、那你可以想象住在里面的都是病比较多比较老的人，家属实在是没有办法照顾才送进去的，那么这些老人呢，你说叫他跟其他的朋友在一起嘻嘻哈哈吗？不可能、哦，他们已经心智上都不太好，而且是他们常年不去刺激自己的脑、哦、他们只能够说这照顾的人这些护理人员跟他讲你要现在做什么，右手抬起来动一动，左手抬起来动一动，这样他们不去训练自己、哦、那么如果说你讲这些住在退休社区的有这个好处是没错了、哦、那么现在就是在慢慢在改的，就是这些退休社区的住在里面的呢，不是一个房间一个房间、哦、而是房间的空间要就距离要拉长了，因为怕传染、哦、那这样的话呢，这种机构的开销会很重，因为它本来是一个范围可以住50个人，现在可能住15个人而已、哦、它空间要扩大、哦、那它的照顾，而且现在为了要给这些老人有足够的刺激脑，像我这个照片那个 slide 上面的那个 telehealth 的 digital ICT 的这些呢，它设备都要改变，那么这个都是要删那个网络的、哦、internet 什么全部要装进去、哦、那这样的话呢，它的设备的费用增加，那么很多老年人、哦、可能包括你我呢都不愿花那个钱住进去了，那么这样的话呢，退而求其次就是只能够住在自己家里、哦、那你家里可以装一些 internet 啊，装什么啦，那么房间稍微改变啦、哦、调整好了，那 照顾的人可以来帮忙的这个，所以现在的走势现在是市场上自然的减低了 74% 了、哦、就是说 74% 的老人说、哦、我们不愿意去住那种机构，不愿意去住退休社区啦，这样那么这样的话呢，变成他的 service 自动调整为 home base 的 service 嘛、哦、这是没有办法的。那这样的话呢，就是说你想这个住在这种社区大家互相联络的那种好处呢，变成要加强在我们像我们健康的 health living 啦、哦、这些互相联络啦，大家一起活动 的部分。那一直到说你的最后阶段身体实在是非常糟糕，一大堆病啦，没有办法才住进去那边。那么这样的话你的财务规划方面就要有足够的资源、哦、我是认为大家都够了、哦、因为你的财产最后那一段几个礼拜就放在那边好好的照顾嘛、哦、让我们身体就是安心的走了、哦、这样的话呢就只能够去住这种机构嘛。那这样的话这一种机构就会关了很多，到后来、哦、以后因为他没办法支援支撑了、哦、变成说只有几家可以留存下来照顾这个最后一段 的这些老人、哦、那其他的比较还好一点的呢可能都是在家里的、哦、那在家里的话变成家属要帮忙了、哦、因为你说 Peter 叫你早餐午餐晚餐你现在还会煮，等到你80岁你就不会煮了嘛、哦、那就要有人帮忙煮给你吃啊，对哦、所以这个就是它等于是市场自动在调整、哦、那么这些长照机构他们也为了应对这个呢赶快在改变、哦、那就是说设备方面改变，设备更新，人员训练，那这样的话呢现在又缺乏人去工作，因为现在年轻人不愿意去做照顾人的工作，那这样就是很头痛、哦、那我知道台湾、哦、亚洲那边是慢慢在调整，在因为它是整个趋势是调整到机构式嘛、哦、那美国西欧这边是因为 pandemic、哦、赶快改成居家式的照顾，所以这个两个不同方向在走了、哦、还有没有什么问题？
陈医师，我刚才听了那个我有一点不懂，你说十年后 会有一个比较大的灾灾害出来，还是这样？
不是，现在就是说流行病啊、哦、这种东西在统计上、嗯、历史上的统计呢、嗯、大的像这个 COVID-19 这一种的呢大概是100年左右了、嗯、一次了、哦
okay. 嗯、
那现在就是比较刺激的呢大概10年左右就会大流行一次、哦
okay, okay.
哦、那现在大家已经怕了以后呢就不敢去住机构了、哦、你看现在流感、嗯、我们还好有打预防针，这样、嗯它的保护还只有30-50%、哦、那美国已经最近已经第一个流感死掉的、哦、已经第一个 case 发生了、哦、所以呢、嗯、就是说每十年左右会有一次，那么现在自然大家说、okay. 哦、我不敢去参加、哦、很多活动、啊、不敢去住那种地方，那么怎么办、哦、你还是要身体还是要照顾啊、哦、心理也要调适啊、嗯、那这样就是说它朝在家里处理的为主、哦、
OK 谢谢。
我希望不要讲的大家吓坏了我是觉得
一天过一天好好的过，
对啊、哦、那你设定好你自己的照顾人生的方向，身体照顾方向，心理调适，然后该做的活动去参加活动，不要都关在家里、哦、因为关在家里是非常不好、哦、它是 isolation、嗯、然后就是变成心理不好， 不能适应这个外面的变迁，然后变成焦虑、忧虑、depression 的都来、哦、所以才说一定要参加活动、哦、
而且朋友之间聊天啊、讲话也是很好，
对呀、啊，至少、啊、而且我们现在最怕的长照、哦、长照我这里有这张图、哦、第一个是 medical care 这是长照的基本的、嗯、第二个是 personal care 这是两项嘛、哦、就是说你身体生病长期的病需要医疗照顾，然后呢你照顾你身体的部分呢像吃饭啦、煮饭啦、洗澡啦，这些呢需要也要自己做啊，但是如果不能做就别人要来帮你忙啦、哦、那这个都是有急性的跟、慢性的嘛、哦、像急性的说你如果说开完刀那 伤口稳定啦、 病情稳定了就送回家去，但是你还是不方便起来上厕所啊、洗澡啦、啊、什么，那么就要别人来帮你照顾了。哦，这个都是属于长照的系统了。哦，居家照顾的系统，那这个呢都是要我们事先要有准备了。哦，财务的准备、人员的配置、家属的陪伴啊，这个都要准备了。哦，
嗯，那个Home care， 如果未来的走向啊是 home care 的话，对，我觉得这个所谓的 home care 就是那个子女就是家属啊的责任变加重了。
对呀、
啊。那我的意思就是说，以前的 model 就是如果经济还过得去的话，子女就是可以。说支持一点，就生活比较正常了、啊，对不对？他们把那个自己的那个长辈送到那个机构，也是有好处，他们是比较专业嘛，对不对？现在如果要 push back home 的话，那个他们的长辈的那个管理那个 health care 就是有点子女要 take over 那个管理的责任，他们就责任就加重了，对不对？
对
呀、
啊，
因为我是过来人，你知道很多人他都照顾自己的长辈过，所以这个变迁就是不是光是那个长辈的那个家属的责任也都加重，以后要怎么办呢？不晓得。
呀，我几个月前有讲到的哈，长照哈，在美国现在是67%的样子是配偶照顾。那配偶大概大部分都是女性的配偶了、哦、那平均年龄配偶的年龄是62岁半，那等于是老人在照顾老人、哦、那1/3是女性的子女、哦、那男性的子女比较少、哦、所以刚刚第一个 speaker 讲的那个 caregiver 的 depression 啦、burden 啦、burnout 啦、哦、就是这样，因为你这些人你说老人照顾老人，我自己有时候觉得已经累得要命了，你还要照顾一个人、哦，那就很惨、哦、那如果说子女他还要上班要养他自己的小孩子，然后又要花时间过来、哦、那这一类的照顾的年轻的照顾者呢，他常常迟到或缺席、哦、缺工了、哦、不去做，因为没有办法、哦、那如果说有几个子女的话呢，你要分工还好，如果大家推责任那就麻烦了、哦、那另外就是说这些老人年纪越大他需要照顾越多，他脑筋也越糟糕，脑筋越糟糕的时候，这个子女呢要懂得老人心理才知道怎么照顾，而不是说 你以为每一个小孩子都会照顾你吗？他不会、哦、他们了解的就是说要一个房间呢，那有一些饭给你吃就够了嘛，还要照顾什么、哦、所以呢变成说有 well trained 的那个 caregiver、哦、这小孩子呢就不多、哦，那么这样的话你说你心理上你说、啊、以后小孩子要照顾你合理吗、哦、他们不会照顾啊、哦、那你说在台湾请个外佣，那以后可能没有外佣了嘛、哦、那在美国是不可以有这些外佣，那你怎么办、哦、所以华盛顿州才规定所有的人都要买长照保险来配给照顾者、哦、那现在问题又来了，谁有什么？为什么要 echo 呢？哦，那现在就是说，愿意去做这个工作的人也不多。哦，现在非常辛苦，很难找这些年轻一代的，他可能愿意去电脑公司上班呢，也不愿意去照顾人。哦，那现在这个也是一个未来的人力资源的问题了。哦，那变成说这样的人愿意去做的，你的工资他一定要涨。一定要涨的话呢，那你的长照的保险能不能负担这一部分，或愿不愿意付这么高、哦、对不对？那这个是个人的选择啦、哦、就是变成说你要去想你愿意照顾到什么情形，做到什么情形、哦、所以第三项有 pre-arrangement， 就是你要照顾到什么程度，那么大概该走了就要走了呢，就你有设立好你的 advance directive 啦、哦、这些讲清楚、哦，那这样的话呢就照这个方向来做了、哦、大概只能够这样、哦、
那个陈医师你觉得这个会不会影响那个以前那个 concept， 那个老人社区这个 concept， 老人社区当然不是就是说是 是集中 healthcare 的那个 setup， 它不一样，不过还是那个概念还是一样，就是老人生活在一起，就是老人社区这个 concept， 你觉得会不会受影响？
它是可能会照现在的趋势，至少现在呢是会减少，就愿意帮助然后搬去那些老人社区。那现在老人社区他们也要存活，所以呢他们就是在改变啊，房子的设置还有距离活动的规划呢，都是要朝上有能够有 social distancing 啊，这些规则要定出来哦，然后能够让这些老人住进去的人能够有更好的活动方式还有学习方式了哦，让他们觉得有意义有帮助哦，值得花那个钱了哦。像我刚提的这些，现在以后的机构全部要有电脑化哦，那网络，所以我一直在想着，那么如果老人不太会用手机，不太会用电脑 iPad， 那怎么办呢？那像我们 Victor 老师在教的 Hi Siri 用语音的呢，或许可以帮忙哦，因为他以后可能不太会用手去按这些键盘，那么怎么办呢？哦，他用口音的或许可以哦，就是说他要学很多这一类的高科技的技能还有功能，因为以后的诊所很多用 telehealth 嘛，哦，用网络看病哦，那这样的话你连这个电脑都不会用，你怎么看病呢？哦，这个都会在改变的哦。那这种需求还是会可以有啦，但是它可能价位会高啦，因为它很多配套的措施啦，设备都要增加哦，那空间要拉长。啊，就是 COVID-19 引起的后续的副作用的。
哦，可不可以讲几句话呢
？Yes， yeah。
你刚才所讲的那一个，现在将来那个长照的测试可能会改成为居家照顾。这个在美国来讲可能还可以，因为为了怕感染都是在家里，但是在东方，譬如说在台湾也好，台湾的房屋都是在一个大 building 里面的房屋，你即使你是在家里，你还是有机会跟你旁边的人接触，譬如说是在那个电梯。在美国我们的那个居家都是一间一间的房屋，跟隔壁有距离，所以这个比较安全。但是呢，因为这个住在家里呢，我们家里都必须要有 remodeling 因为你以前住的家，你现在将来等你年纪比较大的时候呢，你可能有很多不方便，譬如说你的楼上楼下当你年纪比较大的时候，你走路不方便，你上楼也是一个非常困难的事情，那这个也是要增加了一大堆的那个对老人家的这个房屋的设备的改良这是在美国可能还可以，但是在东方呢，这个还是非常困难，能像刚才你所说的这个现在老人将来居家服务的照顾偏向那个也是非常困难的，而且照顾的人以前我们的父母亲都有好几个孩子，现在你我都是只有两个孩子，三个顶多是三个孩子，那这个居家照顾呢，除了你能请人家来照顾以外，你的儿女我不敢说了，我至少我是敢说这是很现实的问题，你将来你不要依靠认为你的孩子能来照顾你当你到八十岁的时候，你的儿女也是差不多是六十几岁了也非常困难来照顾你，所以我认为最重要的还是在这个老身边你要把你好好的照顾自己，照顾到最后呢就像欧洲的呢，最后几个礼拜或者几个月到这个住院式的，让人家，因为我们总就要走的我们总就要，我不认为说是为了我们将来几个 几年的时间呢，我们就改变了我们所有的生活习惯，我们可以住在家里没有问题，但是呢我们把自己好好的照顾，等到最后几年我们还是要照顾在这个集体的 community 的这种照顾的方式，这是免不了的。而且呢我认为这个 community 老人家的 community， 第一是我们的身心比较方面，因为你自己在家里你可能不能得到那么多的生活的乐趣，这是一个现实。看看你是要很孤独的住在家里啊，沟门常言很久，还是好好生活的几段时间呢，然后到那个老人的时候，在那个 care 那个 nursing care 的时间，这是我认为虽然因为这个 COVID-19 改变了，但是呢这个community care 还是很重要的，这不能避免的。好了，谢谢。
Yeah， 没有错，就是刚刚我提的哈。美国西欧国家是本现在阶段呢是注重在集体住宅哈，就是这样，然后大家一起照顾啦，一起生活啦。但是就是说因为这一次疫情发现这一些人他的因为这样的关系确诊然后住院然后过世的比例非常高，那现在就是整个市场改变。但是亚洲地区呢，我听说台湾呢现在也是越来越多的集体住宅、哦、就是住在这一种地方，那么可以预见的这样的情形下呢，那么如果下一次的大爆发的时候，那么他们的生病的比例会增加，住院的比例也会增加，那么就是说生命的那个最后也会比较高了、哦、所以这是亚洲的情形，那么这个他们有那边的情况没有办法。那么现在就是说我们怎么办、哦、那如果说你决定住在亚洲的地区，回去台湾香港哪里，那么就要心理准备上呢，就是要做一些配套了、哦、那如果说住在美国，那么你如果说到现在趋势，如果住在长照机构啦，或者说退休社区啦，那么现在的那个开销很重、哦、最近我一位病人呢，他以前送到 adult family home， 就是需要人住在一个家里，然后他可以照顾七八个人的这种机构呢，在十年前是州政府付一个月1500，那几年前呢，大概是付2500到4000来带看病情，最近呢是8500到10000，那你这样8500到10000还不一定有人有位置，因为照顾的这些 adult home 他们也不愿意那么多病人、哦、那这样的话变成没有地方照顾、哦、那你只能够乖乖在家里了、哦、所以这个是很多因素在互动了、哦、没有那么单纯的想说那么就去住那边、哦、其实是变化很大、哦、所以刚刚雷公讲的呢还是一样，你要好好的老呢，要勤奋的照顾自己，运动参加活动，这样你的身心才能够平衡，才能够好好的享受你的晚年生命，然后到该走的时候呢就拍拍手走了啦、哦、也没有什么好留念，这样才能够快乐的过这个晚年啦、哦、那如果说非常怕什么都怕的话呢也可以啦、哦、但是变成说生命可能会比较没有那么好玩啦、哦、这样所以我写这个、哦、老业精于勤才能够精于息嘛、哦、这样有没有什么要分享的？不要吓坏了，都不敢讲了，因为这个 是相当严肃的一个题目了、哦、所以我也花了相当长时间去找资料还想、哦、
陈医生你好，我想问你，你是刚刚说什么每100年会有一个很严重的那个传染病，那上次是什么时候发生的？
好像是18世纪尾中以后了，就是西班牙大流感嘛，然后更早有黑死病啦、鼠疫啦这些嘛，所以他们统计起来看起来大概是平均每100年就一次这个大的流行了， 那因为整个世界都没有准备，也不知道这种病、哦、所以那个死亡率非常高。你看1857年的样子吧、哦、那个西班牙大流行呢，死了5000万到1亿了、哦、全世界、哦、那这一次的 COVID-19 美国也死了100多万了，确诊1亿多、哦、那美国的政治经济整个被影响非常大、哦、那而且是对整个照顾团队、医疗团队啦、政治的、哦、你看包括总统都不想要怎么办，因为整个 世界都在瞎子摸象，完全不知道这个病是什么、哦、那我们完全不知道的关系，我很清楚那时候2020年2月看情况在改变的时候赶快要去买 N95 呢，我只准许买一盒，下一个礼拜就没有了，不准买、哦、所以呢可以知道这个整个世界那时候就是在彷徨 惊恐之中在过、哦、那我常提说各位关在家里还可以过日子，那这些照顾人员呢是整天在惊恐中，而且非工作不可、哦、所以你看那时候美国马上改变很多法律、哦、华盛顿州也是拜托这些退休的啦医疗人员赶快回来工作，然后外国那边 也聘请他们、哦、有一些专科医师呢在国外是专科但是在美国没有执照，都准许他们来照顾、哦、那这些人现在留在美国，他们说我要留在美国啦，现在美国移民法说不行你要回去、哦、那这个是一个问题了、哦、所以说这个 每一段时间就有一个 大的疫情，所以呢2020年那时候这个 COVID-19 刚出来的时候就开始提说可能下一个 pandemic 是 mental 的心理的忧郁症、哦、所以呢你看今天我们两个 speaker 也是讲主要是讲忧郁有关的心理、哦、除了当事者的心理照顾者的心理都是问题了、哦、我们现在没有感受。那我昨天念一篇呢、美国的医学院学生认为选错行的占了 47% 的样子、哦、他们想要改变、哦、那明年至少现在统计问卷呢 23% 的医护人员 要提早退休、哦、因为都是过劳，所以呢现在就是说很多心理问题了，不是只有这个照顾者，这个很多各行各业都有心理问题，这个是我们要面对的。
我要提醒大家，上帝在控制人口就是疾病跟战争的，只有疾病就是包括传染病的，这个就是我们人口的控制，就是这两个而已，看看你要死在这个疾病或是在战争，像乌克兰就是这样子，哎呀，就是这两个而已。我认为老人家呢，还是 要活得快快乐乐，不是为了要，只是要增加几个月，然后，就自己住在一个很孤独的一个居家，住在家里这样很困难，还是要有快快乐乐的一个生活，这是最重要的。
Yeah, 我们今天有 Health Living 很多 program 哦。就是欢迎大家参加，就是就鼓励大家参与、哦、因为你的参与呢我保证可以减轻你的失智失能的情况、哦、因为只能够这样，所以他说业精于勤，那个勤就是你一定要设定好而且要参与、哦、那训练你自己做这些活动、哦、那这样的话呢变成习惯你可以 enjoy 那才会快乐了、哦、那不然的话我们每天看的这些媒体、哦还有看电视呢都是很不健康、哦、那些媒体讲的话有些是乱七八糟、哦、那不知道怎么办、哦、那所以呢快快乐乐的过每一天的日子、哦、那是比较合理的啦、哦、
刚才就是关于陈医师有提到的这一些会在宅安老，然后还有这些家庭照顾的问题，我们健安其实也有一些照顾的服务，然后还有一些这个家庭支援的服务，所以我刚才有把连结放在 chat box 里面、大家也可以直接在网页上面搜寻我们健安的这个、网址，直接打进去，那下面也有电话、哦、下面有电话您可以打电话过来，然后或者是 email 给我们，那还有我们的 Healthy Living Program 可以就是达到陈医师刚才所提到的就是我们现在的投影片这个 To die young and as late as possible， 也就是说不要让那个不能够自理，要让不能够自理的这个时间越短越好。那要怎么样能够达到这样子的效果呢？除了吃的营养以外，然后还有就是要多活动，多出来参加我们的活动。一会儿也会再把我们的 Healthy Living 的这个Connect 把它放在那个上面。然后呢，我想要询问一下大家有没有对 Christopher or Ashika 今天的 presentation 有没有什么问题想要跟他们请问的。 I'd like to ask if there are any questions for Christopher and Ashika because they are still here waiting for the questions and respond to you. If you have any questions, you can ask them right now. For example, if you want to know someany documents you want to prepare before you get really sick or anything you need to prepare in advance. If you have any questions, you can ask them right now.
Yeah, 也可以用中文问哈。那第一个是讲照顾者的忧郁症哈。因为家属要照顾，那么他引起的很多的心理问题、身体问题，那他是专门的在帮忙这一部分。第二个演讲者是讲，如果有什么问题，他的这个团队呢，心理的复健部分来帮你，慢慢，这个都是有一套的专业的训练方式，那如果大家有这个问题，你可以用中文问我们，帮你翻译过去也可以，
Ask in Chinese and we can translate into English for the speakers.
对，然后如果有问题是想要私下问的话，也可以在 chat box 里面我有放一个 survey， 如果可以 fill out 的话，也可以直接 connect 你们给今天的 speakers 或者是不同的组织。
大家都很害羞，
所以看来这个健安的 group 大家都活得很快乐，所以比较没有忧郁的问题，又这个大家都 physically independent， mentally 也都很 independent， 所以我们如果说继续这样子的 program 呢，一直下去，那到最后就会像这张图片一样啊。As late as possible， 可是是 independent 的啊，这个就是那个老生的那个第四点啊，就是我们尽量做 preventive major 啊 ，preventive major， 然后同时在做 prevention 的当中呢，去 enjoy the life 啊，那 enjoy the life 有一个蛮重要的就是 creation 啊 ，creation 你参与的时候又会有很多这个不同的 idea 出来啊，那个。那像建安的 program 画图啊写字啊唱歌啊这些都是一个跳舞也是啊都是非常creativity 的这个这一部分的 mental function 的 maintain 哦所以很好啊只是呀、一点感想
呀、所以我今年来我一直努力做的就是我看到这些老人尤其是在长照机构啦或者集体住宅里面的老人呢，他们的活动都非常的有限度、不多、那么我在想说，假如我到他们的年龄的时候也是这个样子的话呢，这个是很不好的生命、所以呢，我自己在想说，那么我怎么能够独立来做我自己要做的、那以前是说我们大家在一起唱个歌卡拉 OK， 但是我发现一条歌学一年都还学不太起来、只会唱旧歌、那你说我去打高尔夫球很好啊对不对去走路啊对只有走路那其他的呢你肩膀痛了啦腰痛了啦也不能打了那么有什么东西可以自己一直做到90岁如果还活着的话可以做的是什么、可以自己去选出来 然后去学、哦、那我最近就是努力在学的是温医师的养生功啦、太极拳啦这些，这个你可以独立自己做的、哦、你把我送到疗养院去我都可以独立自己做的是什么，那么我现在要努力的去训练、哦、就是业精于勤、哦、努力去训练规律的去做，这些都背下来了都会做了，不管知识对不对至少你背下来会做，你就可以 enjoy 你要做的这个活动，而且是比较 independent 的、哦、不是变成说别人叫你现在右脚抬起来你就抬一下，这样的话就是很可怜、哦、所以呢，我就朝自己想要的来做，然后趁现在还学得到东西呢赶快去学，学会了你就可以继续做下去、哦、那这样的话呢就等于是一种养生的方式了、哦，那这个是等于是 Healthy Living 里面有很多 program 你可以选几样然后固定的去做、哦、那我们不需要学每一样都去参加、哦、那会累死，那么你选几样三样两样、哦、然后你固定去做，这个变成你的 routine、哦、那等于是你的 preventive， 然后如果这样做还是生病了那就是 curative、哦、该治疗的去治疗，配合医疗团队的治疗，那没办法好好改善的情况那就是 palliative care， 那这样我们的生命就比较能够稳定平稳了、哦、那这一张 slide 上面有一个 MSO 呢，它这个是现在的趋势，医疗团队的趋势呢，它等于是给你包起来、哦、它给你 arrange 所有的东西、哦、你的门诊啦、治疗啦、药啦什么，那变成说这个是机构导向了、哦、但是这是一个趋势了、哦、所以你可以看 CVS 药房系统，他现在买了很多医疗保险，他就是要指挥这些医疗系统照他们的指定方向照顾了、哦、这是现在的趋势、哦、所以呢，这个就是说我们自己要定好你要的是什么，然后好好的去做，那就这样走完每一个人的生命、哦、那重点是有比较好的品质了、哦、那这个，Go ahead。
我们在那个 chat box 里面有把我们HLP 的 program 的这个连接有放在上面，然后刚才 ICHS 的 Angel 也有把我们 ICHS 会提供的服务，就是有疫苗的注射，也有把一些连接放在上面，大家如果有时间的话可以去点选一下。然后呢，我们有一个课后的 survey。那就如果大家有时间也帮我们点一下，那如果需要跟我们的讲师，今天的讲师Christopher Ashka or Dr. Chen 联络，我们在这个 survey 上面也有这个连接的部分，如果您有勾选的话，我们会就是把您的问题转交给我们今天的 speaker。
还是一样鼓励大家尽量训练自己能够独立生存、哦，那不要心理上一直依赖说要靠着其他人靠着家人、哦、那能够自己独立就是要学很多东西、哦、像电脑科技，现在我们有 Victor's 的课，礼拜一礼拜五他有很多东西呢，你自己生活起居上可以学到的都可以来学、哦、还有我们其他的运动活动，这些都是适合我们这个年龄，那你可以选几样，他都有录影带给你、哦，那你选几样就固定来做也可以、哦、反正就是要动、哦、要活就要动、哦、脑筋要动身体要动、哦、那这样才能够平稳的过了、哦、那现在的长照呢，因为这个除了机构式的以外，现在就往居家照顾方向在走、哦、因为市场方向在朝这方面变，那么我们就是要先开始准备调试、哦、这照顾你的人在哪里，钱在哪里，那你的住的地方在哪里，然后好好去想去规划，这个都是长照的一部分、哦、那这样就可以平稳的过我们这个晚年了、
哦、OK, thank you Dr. Chen, and we appreciate all the efforts from our speakers from ICHS, from Aegis Gardens Newcastle, and also Dr. Chen from Ping An, and we appreciate all the efforts and thank you April and thank you Angel. If you have some more questions about our Healthy Living program, please ask us or email us at healthyliving@kingan.org. If you have any questions about today's seminar or lecture, you can email us too. So if there is no other questions, I'd like to call it to wrap it up. And thank you, everyone. Thanks. We appreciate your participation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And thank you, our speakers. We appreciate
that. Thank you, speakers.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Have a good lunch.
Have a good lunch. Bye. Thank you, April. Thank you, Angel. Thank you, Dr. Chen and Christopher and Ashika. Bye-bye.
Okay,
goodbye,
bye-bye,
everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.